I think I'm online.
All right, wish me luck. See how it goes.
I'm one of them, so 10 viewers.
You don't count?
Christina counts as an offline viewer.
Yeah, okay. Offline online viewer.
What's that?
Offline on-site code reviewer.
What's that?
An offline offline.
Oh, it's, you're just messing
she's
with me.
She's offline, but she's...
I'm offline, but like,
we're
online.
We're watching you. You're like a 30-second delay or something.
Fancy.
It's good stuff.
I'm so no good with the internet.
Yeah, they can hear me.
As you can ask the people watching right now, they know I'm super low bed with the internet.
Awesome.
Feels good to be back. Hey guys, let me know if you have any questions. I'm just back on the wheel for the first time in a long time, wanted to share it with you guys. But I will, of course, answer anything that you ask.
delay every time it'll go. It's like long, and you got a short current. So you have longer and then shorter to here.
Nobody's asking any questions.
You hear noise or something? Why? Oh, Allison Stowe Castellano says, why or how many times do you come to play before creating the piece?
Ooh, good question. So if I were going to be just making one huge piece out of this, I would probably go ahead and center maybe 10 to 15 times. There's a couple things that I'm doing here. It's not just for fun. Number one, I'm tiring out my hands. Very important. The hands are too active. They try to desperately control. That's why you'll see in the beginning I did all kinds of slapping. All kinds of slapping. That both centered the piece artificially, but it also got my hands to start to relax, overtire them. So now, I'm aligning all the particles into a spiral that matches the spin direction of the wheel. Since the clay moves as a fluid, it's spiraling in and out of itself, up and down. But not until you feel the silence of the core can you say that your whole piece is centered. So that's why I'm doing so much center. However, the type of centering I'm doing is very conservative in my style. I'm only bringing it up about maybe twice as tall as it is wide. So I'm not getting a full center to my liking. But that's because I'm mostly centering just the top. I'm going to be making several pieces off of this piece of clay. And so I want to prepare mostly the top. And that's why you'll see I stop about right here. In case you're wondering, I'm making tea canisters for my tea room, for my new teas that just came in. So now this ratio right here is about where you want to be in my centering style. And that's roughly the amount of clay that I'm really focusing on centering. Because of the centering style, even though I'm focusing just on the top, it is going to center the areas underneath as the core drills its way downward during the downward motion. Then as I bring it up, the center is vacuumed upwards to the center. And that also pulls the clay upwards, allowing me to center what's underneath by centering what's above.
I forgot about. I know what's in there, but I forgot about Cody. I was like, what am I missing so much? Like a lot of pieces are gonna pass me though.
Alright, about time. Made my first mistake. Pushed the clay a little bit too hard and snapped it, introducing an air bubble. This is going to be fun. And that's the main thing that you forget when you've gone away for a while, is to be soft. Clay spinning like this, the only job it has is to get out of the way. And if you give it time, it'll do that. Oh man, it feels good to do that. That was a little note for my body. So I took the air bubble, put it in the middle, and now I'm piercing right through it. And that's a very lazy way to get rid of an air bubble. Glad you guys are enjoying this.
Are you pulling from the website?
Mm-hmm.
That's a question in chat. I don't actually know what that means.
So I throw in an Eastern method where the wheel is going clockwise. There's a couple reasons why I decided on this. Number one, I accidentally only learned from people that had learned from Japanese potters. I didn't know this at the time, but when I first started doing it, the only people that I ever saw do it did it in the Eastern style. So when I decided to do pottery and just bought my own pottery wheel, that's what I just thought you needed to do. And it wasn't until later when I took a class in pottery that I found out what I was doing was what people called backwards throwing. But there's a second reason why I use it. Number two is that I found it to be the most effective way to focus on our strengths and to turn our weaknesses into something that is more positive, something that I would say is more neutral. And that is, my left hand isn't very agile. It is very strong, but it's not agile. So I use it for holding still, and then I use my interior hand as my intelligent hand to be able to react to anything that's happening and guide the whole process. My body is getting so excited, the adrenaline's running. That never happens on the wheel. Poor body. How cool. Nice little confirmation that I need to be on the wheel more. Okay. So I've got roughly the cylinder I'm looking for. I got my height to width ratio that I would like for my tea canisters. Now I'm going to remove all the liquid clay that might remain in the interior because I don't need it anymore. In fact, it's detrimental. Don't forget that despite using water as a medium of travel, clay and water are actually almost enemies. And as you add more water to your piece, the more likely your piece is going to turn into a liquid version, a very mobile version of the clay, because the whole thing's liquid, honestly. And so before you do all of your shaping, I like to dry it off. Sometimes I'll even go as far as drying off the outside like that, but I don't need it. So just one time, I'm going to go up along the wall while using my tool, and this is just to reinforce my shaping. First, I'm going to start off by making sure the base is nice and dense. And I'm almost pressing into my own hand at the base. Then I'm going to transition into the wall and do a soft glide all the way up. And right about here, I'm going to switch and make my tool rise above and my fingers below to encourage keeping with the shape that I've already created. Okay. Now I want my canisters for my tea room to be a little bit tall. Kind of like in my style. They're going to be almost urn-like. Yeah, I hope you like it. It works really well for me. If you go to my place page, you'll find a lot more videos of me actually talking about what I'm doing. And soon I'm gonna add a really nice video that explains, kinda in my words, my process that I've kind of worked on over these years. Now I'm mostly done with the very bottom and the bottom corners. Now I'm going to go back and just clean up the interior so that when archaeologists dig this thing up, they won't be critiquing the way I left it. Don't forget that your pots are one of the only things that are going to survive in this world. And so, you know, not necessarily take pride in them. However, try to make them as well as you can so that in their long lasting, perhaps they can use far past the time that we survive on this planet. Okay, and there's my shoulder. Now since I'm done with the bottom, I'm going to lightly just glide along to increase the strength. And once again, that's by removing the water and making it more dense. I don't usually do this, but I want just to emphasize the fact that when you're learning this method, you do want to make sure that you keep your pieces dry. That way you don't have to worry about them collapsing as you use more water as you go along. Now remember, when you bring it in, you make it thicker, and so you go back and thin out the clay. Thicker again. Awesome, I've reached resonance. You hear it? That's my pot.
Oh.
So the vibration produced by the spinning wheel is reacting with the chamber of air in the inside of here, and it just happens to reach a resonance chamber, and it's making sound.
Cool.
Well, hello, Mr. Pottery.
You're going to do a sound class?
I know, right? And in case you forgot, this is going to be a canister, and that's why I sealed in the top. As usual, I designed the piece for the interior shape, and so this will become a much more beautiful shape as I trim. now time to make my place where I'm going to bring the two together and create my lid later. Okay, and then finish up by creating the shape of the top that I want. Remove any excess clay. I do want to make sure that I have enough clay to make sure I have a good seal. So it's almost as though I'm centering this little tiny piece of clay right at the top. Don't let it sag on itself. When that happens, use your tool, create some pressure at a diagonal, and return it to a round shape before you move on. Once it begins to sag on itself, you're in a little bit of trouble. They're a lot more limited when you have negative angles. You want to make sure that these angles are always as positive as possible. It's all the same structural principles.
Yeah.
The universe operates in many different ways. There.
Hi.
Welcome back. You off?
I am off.
Oh my God! So you're back on the real estate. Back on the real estate, making these houses.
Real estate.
Construction. Construction's booming.
I think small this.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, all your stuff's ready, I think. Alright, tea canister number one. Notice I don't really care about measuring or nothing like that. Honestly, I'm just working on learning how to throw. Later, when I become real good at this, then I might develop some kind of worry about the sizes and shapes and ounces and all that fancy stuff. If I ain't getting paid for producing a certain ounceage, I don't even bother. Life's too short to worry. Especially about stuff you're making for yourself. Unamash. Now this is going to get a lot easier. Thank you. And that's what I call a core center. With porcelains, they're a lot more electric. They have much smaller particles. They have a lot more magnetism. You can really force those things into some crazy, crazy arches. This one here, since the particles are so large and it's primarily pug, it's lost a lot of its very small particles during that pugging process, so I can't really push it too hard. It's above the max. Any taller than this, and the thing will break in half. Now, it might even happen now, which would be fun, because you get to see what happens then.
Yeah. It's just like, I just imagine a bunch of people just all lined up, just like, see if you can make the tallest.
Oh, I know. I don't know anybody else that does this.
Really?
Yeah. Imagine a winding river. Clay travels very similar. There's energy in the bank. There's energy in the river.
I think I've done some pieces off my own before. You're like, that would be definitely top of the pit.
We can fix your method. We can make it stronger, faster.
Power!
Thank you for watching. All right. So that's enough centering for this section. Remember, I'm primarily centering the top half. That's where I'm focusing all of the density. Oh, feels so good.
Right now, I'm like, I'm not going very far.
just stuff that starts really wide.
Really wide. I was like, lucky I'm going so thick right now.
Short cone.
Very short nice cone. Time to practice trimming.
Yeah, I've never been done much longer trimming.
Really?
I mean, I feel like a lot of the clay stuff, like, I, like, know hypothetically know how to do it all, and then when I get to it, I'm just kind of like, But I think also my experience with clay was, like, in school, when there was, like, deadlines, and, like, there was other, like...
Oh, man, I'll get you to love trimming. So,
I mean, I think trimming is a lot cleaner. It doesn't get my OCD as much.
Now, right there, I did something I don't usually do, and you'll see why in a moment. Rather than try to make something wider, I kind of just pushed real hard and brought the face in, which is going to make it a little structurally weaker here in a minute, and you'll see what that looks like. Now, most of the time, I can get this kind of structure back, because clay always remembers where it came from. But we'll see. Okay. This is when it'll express itself. Since it didn't move according to the vortex that I had cultivated, and I pushed it out in a different direction, when I try to activate it, it's going to behave differently than all the rest of the clay around it. That'll express itself in like a wobble that shows up for about a second and a half for about maybe 15 rotations. There it is. And now it's finding its old home back where it belongs. And they were all there ready to greet it.
decaying, finish with the density of the bottom, and clean it up for archaeologists' sake. They too want to have nice things. No matter what you think of your pottery, it is going to end up in a museum with a good chance of likelihood, given a large amount of time.
Yo. Welcome back, Lisa.
But it's like, it's, on the inside, it's like... I'm gonna trim the outside.
No, I've got Potter's Wheel today. We also have a whole bunch of phone books. We finally found use for the phone book in the modern age. And you use them to put underneath your piece when you set it down. That way, it never sticks.
Oh. I guess I always like do something to the bottom of it, so if it sticks a little, it's like
fair enough.
And then
makes it easier to get it off of there because sometimes it suctions and you have to cut it off. Right, it's just extra work. No, you're good. We just try to save as much energy as possible here. That's what all those phone books are for. Nothing ever sticks.
You just put it on the front book and put it on the bat, or just put it on the
bat. Yeah, just cut out a page, put it on the bat, and you set it right down on top of that.
Oh, just the page.
Yeah.
I was thinking like the whole. I was like, you guys need
phone. Whole phone book per piece. No.
Everyone gets their own phone book. Bring your own phone book.
No, it's only useful for the fact that it can resist space between the clay and whatever object you set it on. Save you a lot of trouble in the long run. Thank you.
almost done with canister number two. Watch out, buddy. It's hard to recover from being covered with clay for a fly. Silly buddy. Well, that's life, right? We test our boundaries, and sometimes it pays off, and sometimes you get covered in clay. Is that clay karma? Have to get the rest through shortly.
Having a party with sound effect. Oh, too big. So silly.
Because that's going to be from a refreshing herb tea. Which I have 3 pounds of right now. You remember those days?
dealing with pounds and pounds of tea.
I was like, are you talking about work?
The good old days of being in a tea room.
We do like 300 pound bags.
Yeah, it's big, like
giant.
You guys order from ITI?
From ITI.
International Tea Importers.
If that's the company, the old man that my boss goes to, she's directly from the farm.
Old Indian man, or are you talking old about Chinese tea? Oh, cool.
Chinese and
awesome. So direct from the source.
Yeah, like they're like her parents, old.
Did you guys sell Oriental Beauty?
Is there another name for that?
Chinese name.
What's the Chinese name?
I wouldn't be able to tell you.
Yeah, because like a lot of them are like straight like Iron Goddess, like Peng Guanyin, or like.
Oh yeah, Longjing.
Yeah,
all that stuff.
Yeah, like everything's like something oolong or like it's something like what from whatever the. It looks like so good. Yeah. No, we don't have that. They don't have that one. Yeah, the big ones we have, they have a lot of of course the tea shops where they focus on oolongs, you know, and then they have their like really like early harvest like green tea, like they call it finest.
Uh-huh.
And that's like you get like, you know, 100 pounds per ounce for that. And then I feel like you remember like native cultivar?
Yeah.
Like those are one of my favorites. They have like the native cultivar, and then like the farmers get a lot of like the Yishang, like the bug bitten ones, like the honey sweet ones. So there's like a native cultivar, like Yishang, it's like super delicious.
Really?
Yeah, because it's just like so honey sweet.
You have to bring some in.
Yeah. Oh yeah. Oh yeah. Oh yeah. I'll bring some. It's like because I had a last like half pound of like. Straight native cultivar that the farmers had, and that was like the last of the native cultivar, and then I like lost it to the world. Amy's almost lost like 200. Amy's my old housemate, she works there. She almost was like, I almost forgot like my like, you know, $200 for the tea, like this little canister, $200 for the tea in this restaurant. How do you remember to get it?
Awesome.
Yeah, I think that's the one. Like, I think the one thing with tea names that like a lot of them are just named different stuff, and so I never know like what is actually what sometimes, unless it's just like, you know, something that's very like Beidou, it doesn't like change names or like. I wonder.
Yes. Some of it's produced by this woman named Rebecca Yu. Yeah, we're one of her biggest fans.
You get tea from her?
No, gosh, Oriental Beauty is so expensive.
Like, I'm assuming it's probably on par with like Beidou and all those really like
Beijing teas.
Or there's like one of them is like one. Of, I think I don't know if it's Beidou or not, but I feel like there is. Like one of them is like the. It's like you can't actually get like the real tea leaf because there's only like so many of the trees left and they're like under like guard by the country. What do you call it? Is Dai Lin, you ever heard of that one? That one's supposed to be rare. Probably out of the old age table.
No, I hope to taste all these things. I'm totally new to the tea world.
Mine's a $35 cake. That's an older cake. Yeah, I'll bring you some.
I went to go watch a documentary on it just to learn more, you know, on tea. And James Norwood Pratt all over the documentary. Everywhere.
But I feel like a lot of Eastern. I don't know. I feel a little jaded from my old boss because she just doesn't like him. And Amy's like.
Hey,
you don't like him.
Yeah, they're
teens. Yeah, I would consider them tea snobs.
Yeah, I can't wait to meet them.
We'll see if they ever come this way. Amy, come visit me. Amy.
There's this guy here that'll teach you how to throw pottery in like 2 days.
What if you guys had a guy
one
off?
Oh, that'd be fun.
Oh, I see. Oh, I thought you were saying guy one off. I don't think that. What are you looking at me? I was like, I'm not a guy in this. I don't know what you're talking about.
Guy one.
Yeah, that would be ironic, right? If the guy won.
Being really, really chill about everything.
Super chill about everything.
Yeah. That's why I knew that Amy was meant for pottery, because she's so chill.
What about Alaska?
Yeah, she's from Alaska.
It's finally dry.
A little too much so.
It's the way in the best of Mexico.
Yeah.
Teach for real. Okay. 2.5 hours.
I was like, look, 45.
Well, I mean, half hour cleanup, but 2 hour class.
I mean, for me, it's like 4 hour cleanup, pretty much. They get all like.
That's why that's crazy.
Yeah.
Yeah, we don't mess around here. I mean, we did a lot of general research, you know, and one of the things about education in general is micro class size, long classes. That's how people learn.
Well, and the cleaners are like for 3D things, like the clean time is just like majority of your time.
Right?
Set up and clean time.
Yeah, I don't know how people could do it with a 45-minute class.
Well, I mean, I remember, like, it was nice and cool, but it was, like, 6-hour classes. Those are the best.
Where's the nearest outlet?
6-hour class is perfect. Right
there.
Behind this green bucket, you'll see a power plug. Super fancy. Never had a 6-hour class.
Yeah, I can only put it.
That might be a good number, though.
Yeah.
It will be, because I can't walk off the table. But my onion.
One onion? Getting a little too deep for you.
Yeah, it is. Must be time for you to refill it.
It is more than time. I just need to get me some crank grease. Oh, and don't forget, that's locked up there.
Oh, it was locked up.
Yeah.
So when the coffee shop is not a coffee tea shop.
Always the back entrance.
The back. Okay.
Yeah.
I think I only discovered that last time I was here.
Oh, really?
I mean, this is only my third time here, but...
Yeah, now, when I have free time, I leave both open. But anytime I'm occupied, It's always studio entrance.
Everybody, what about you today?
So heel down, press the button in until it lights up. The button. Okay, and then you throw standard, so flip it down.
Okay, I would have hopefully figured that out. Mm. Although one time I did throw an entire pot backwards.
Yeah.
Without actually being aware of it.
Well, at one point, looks like you're in neutral, so go down one more time. There you go.
Yeah.
One time I busted my right hand and had to teach and produce left-handed only.
Mm.
No, not even using my right hand at all. That was fun. And that's how I learned how to throw an 8-inch cylinder with one hand.
Definitely an adventure.
Believe it or not, all my one-handed watchers, it is possible to make an 8-inch cylinder with just one hand. No problem.
Well, I might fight you on the no problem.
Well, I mean, if you're if you only got one hand,
yeah,
throwing pottery with one hand, that's no problem.
You can't,
you know what I mean?
Yeah.
If you've already been through the process of losing your hand, learning how to throw with one hand, that's nothing. That's the best thing about our trials and tribulations, right?
Yep.
We have brushes in the shelf over there.
Brushes.
You just dip it in the water, coat it.
Oh.
What's up?
When you come to a stop, there's a big rush, but I'm doing blazing today.
Awesome.
Lots of stuff on that top.
If only I wouldn't put your stuff on the tip tops.
That's right.
But it's because I just like helping you.
I understand, yes. And it's a good idea. I like to keep my stuff. I like to not come in and find it broken.
Exactly.
Speaking of, I put back on the rim on that, the foot on that big piece.
Which one?
The big putter.
Oh, good.
Yeah,
you saw that?
Yeah.
Yeah, I just picked it up.
Yeah.
Stayed
well,
back.
Because there was, I put that on when it was
too dry.
But that's why I'm making now one, a mold for it, rather than using the original platter. Then I won't have to worry about the rim on the platter.
Yeah.
You guys don't use rasps, do you?
I don't even know what a rasp is, so I can tell you that I don't.
Okay.
What's a rasp?
It's just the blade off a wood rasp.
Oh, it's a wood rasp.
And they use it to just quickly remove a whole hell of a lot of clay off the base.
Really?
For those of us who have a hell of a lot of clay, we have to remove from the base.
I have a lot of clay on the base. I use a triple-edged tool with a gouger. And I just push right down the center and it just flies out. I'll have to show you.
knocking it off center each time.
There's one next to the gray shelf where it usually is. Inside the hand building area.
Oh, inside the hand building.
Where the slips used to be, behind that shelf where there's usually step stools and stuff.
Oh, yeah.
It would be an overstatement to say that I sympathize with you.
unfortunately, that is very, very part of it. I'm constantly doing that, and that's why I gave up on the clay holding way, and I use the chucks now. Since I'm just going to be knocking it off center all the time, I shouldn't have it connected to the wheel, you know.
I want my gift and grip.
Oh.
The wimp way.
I don't know about that. I find mine to be much easier. I think the gift and grip takes a lot longer and is a lot harder to use. And that was my first time on the wheel since September 17th. Thanks y'all for watching. In case you didn't know, Corlett, I'm live streaming right now.
cracked it.
Well, all the way through?
No, the edge, the top edge cracked.
Oh, that's what that sound was.
Make it a lot shorter.
That's what I do. She's like, I'm just having fun.
Yeah. I must say it was, the throwing part was easier for these three than it was for the preceding two. So
oh, good.
I'm making progress. Mm-hmm. I could just figure out when to get back in and trim.
Yeah. Get used to the timing of whatever place you're in.
Well,
and if I remember,
since your hours are kind of limited, you know, I can't come in at like 8 o'clock in the morning. Because what I probably
although should, you do have options of 9 and 9. Don't forget.
That's true. Like what I should have done yesterday was come in right at noon, uncover everything, leave,
come
or
back.
Do something else. Come back at 4 o'clock.
Exactly.
Or, you know, something like that.
Yeah, so what I'm going to do is I'm just going to leave these suckers completely uncovered. And then tomorrow morning at 7 in the morning, I will turn them on their side. And then probably around noon, I'll trim them. Just to let you know how that's going to go. Either that, or if I'm real smart, I'll set them up on top of Chuck's upside down. And that Chuck will also dry it out, too.
Well, I put my stuff usually on a drywall bat, or a drywall wear board.
Uh-huh.
Which speeds up sucking the damp out of the bottom.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I like that.
Nothing ever works consistently.
Except for nothing. Ha! Thanks again, y'all, for watching.